Sit down. Camp Constitution. When we want your attention, we're going to say, Camp Constitution, heads up! And no matter what you're doing, you're going to say, heads up! And your head's going to go up, and you're going to face the person that gave you the command.
I like that.
Let's try it and see if it'll work. Just talk amongst
yourselves. Okay, talk about it.
Have a good time.
Camp Constitution, heads up! Oh, I like that. All right.
You got to go, Camp Constitution, heads up! And you respond,
heads up!
And we can move on.
All right, try it again. Talk among yourselves. Be disinterested.
Camp Constitution, heads up!
Heads up!
All right, we're good. All right, before we introduce I have some good news, or should be bad news. This is the next to last class you'll have. You're supposed to say, we love more, Mr. Shirley.
No,
all
right. I don't.
Okay, I do want to introduce you to some very distinguished gentlemen that are sitting in, and there's going to be a presentation this afternoon. Mr. Jean-Pierre Moreau.
You said me?
Okay. Always in California. Mr. George Jake. He's a World War II veteran. He's the author of one of the Uncle Sam books. And where's Fred Holditch?
Right here.
Well, Fred's going to do a present. This is not a class. It's a presentation right after lunch, 12:45, even earlier if you can. And then we're going to take the optional field trip, but we hope that you'd want to come. A lot of you would want to come. All right. Anyway, Mr. Wallace, I got a chance to meet this fine man about a year ago. And that's how I met Fred, and that's how I met Mr. Moreau. See how things connect. Anyway, Mr. Wallace is the author of The Three-Dimensional Leader. He's also got a CD, but The Three-Dimensional Leader is a book about leadership. And all of you in this room have potential to be leaders. Not just followers, leaders, and leaders for freedom, not just leaders for the wrong thing. Some of you will be CEOs of corporations that will stop funding abortion with your 501c3s.
Amen.
Right? Some of you are going to be pastors, ministers. Some of you are going to be football players where you need a presence, a strong, proper Christian presence. One of you will be the next director of Camp Constitution. Well, I mean, not the next one, but a director of this camp. Maybe you'll start your own camp. Maybe we'll get a camp in Ohio, and Mr. Tommaso back there will be a camp director. You see? See? All of you, how many Gen Coffees do we have in this room, ladies? How many future Gen Coffees do we have? Maybe one or two, or five, or ten? You better believe it. That's what this is about. So without further ado, let's give a nice warm hand.
Please come forward, and I'm going to need you all to stand up. We're going to teach you something. We're going to teach you the hand motions to the chorus of this song. We're going to do it slow, and then we're going to do it in combat speed. It has to be a drill sergeant in the military, so we always do things slow, and then we do it in combat speed. So here we go. I don't want to block the screen. Where do I go when I need a shelter? Where do I go when I need a friend? Hug the people on both sides. Where do I go when I need some help in? Where do I go when all my needs are there? That's clap, knee, knee, clap. Now you can't do this with this. Now we're gonna act a little crazy. We're gonna act a little cool a little bit. Now, here's the challenge. The people that don't join us are the ones that are going to run out of this room and tell everybody what we did. So if we all do it together, we have this on each other. Let's start one more time slow. Where do I go when I need a shelter? Where do I go when I need... Hug the people on both sides. Where do I go? Hold those hands. When I need some help. Where do I go? Combat speed sounds like this. Here we go. Where do I go when I need a shelter? Where do I go when I need a friend? Where do I go when I need some help? Where do I go? Where do I go by. Listen and I'll tell you why. Where do I go when I need a shelter? Where do I go when I need a friend? Where do I go when I need some help? Where do I go? Sure as the winter, sure as the winter goes after the fall. Sure as true love tears down any wall. Jesus is able to carry it all. He will answer your call. Where do I go when I need a shelter? Where do I go when I need a friend? Where do I go when I need some help? Where do I go? Oh, he's my shelter. Jesus is my friend, my savior. He helps me. Where do I go? That's fine. I said, where do I go? Back on my knees again. I said, where do I go? Back on my knees. Oh, praise the Lord. Let's see. Where do I go? Back on my knees again. Can we have one dignified clap for my helper? Ready? I wrote a song called Superhero for God, and I was going to do that one with you too, but it's got really, really cool motions to it, but we're running out of time. Hal, how much time do I actually have?
It ends at 10 minutes of 12.
35 minutes.
I turned my clock off. I am Earl Wallace. I am the three-dimensional leader. There are three dimensions of leadership. I'm going to talk to you about them today. We're going to talk about the three dimensions of leadership. We're going to talk about the leadership that our founding fathers brought to America and the value system that the founding fathers used. And then I'm going to challenge you to take this information forward and use it in your lives. Today's message is called Leadership for a Renewed America, the Ten Commandments' Role in Restoring Our Republic. How's that for a bunch of bounce bell nuts? It's going to be really fun and really positive. My name is Earl Wallace. I want to give you a little bit of background about myself. What I do is I develop and inspire leaders who fulfill Americans' mission to pursue life, liberty, and happiness by using the resources that God gave our country. People provide us with the most potential. So I've read a good book. And the way the government is supposed to behave is within the context of the Constitution. So we want them to conform to what the Constitution says. And believe it or not, what the Constitution says is really in the Ten Commandments.
Right.
There's a biblical value system that we need to use to achieve goals. Give you an overview of where we're going today, a roadmap for today's message. We're going to talk about the three dimensions of leadership. We're going to find out whether you're a Samson, a Samuel, or a Deborah. We're going to look at what I call the MRCs of America. The book is subtitled Mission, Resources, and Context. What are the MRCs of America? And then we're going to talk about the context for renewing America, the Founding Fathers and the Ten Commandments, and what's your role in leading today's renewal. I started out, when I got out of there, I became a high school English teacher. I worked at a school called Saratoga Senior High. I had 92-94% of my students passing Regents exams each year that I taught. When I taught high school English, most people were getting 50% of their kids or lower to pass high school Regents exams. And even today, the highest I've read about is about 76%. So I was very, very good at getting kids to connect to very, very sophisticated information. I was a Shakespearean Regents teacher, predominantly, although I had all groups of kids. Then I became a veterans advocate, and I helped a veteran who lived in Boston Spa to win the largest retroactive settlement in VA history. The federal government had to pay that veteran a retroactive check, 100% disability, 1954 to 1994, a 40-year check. Then I began moving up in the system and taking over organizations. Everybody said, oh, you can never do this, and the organization has always failed at doing that. And sometimes when you mention a number of people in government, their eyes roll in the back of their head. But I've always managed by numbers. And my greatest achievement in government is taking up 116 employees or so, and that I'd never achieved in 25 years. And within 6 months, deploying the mission, resources, and context model, we exceeded all of our customer productivity goals. And I also got a union shop up and running for the purpose of having them negotiate on behalf of the citizens of New York a employee evaluation plan that helped us to get rid of our poor employees and to honor the ones that were doing their jobs. My business experience has taught me that most problems we have are related to how human beings function, how they process information, and I started asking God, what is going wrong with America? Why are all of our churches collapsing? And the Lord gave me the leadership model of mission, resources, and context. We have to focus on the mission that matters most. We have to rally the resources to God's cause and inspire them, and we have to understand the context, the relevant variables, the politics, the organizational dynamics, structure for achieving anything. So I wrote the three-dimensional leader to bottle this leadership system. I wanted to inspire the little person to know that you can achieve. And I wanted to provide a system for how organizations make effective decisions. One of the things I do with companies is I have them identify their mission, their visions, and their values, and I help them understand if you have a mission, you have some resources to fulfill it. What's the context for the environment in which your resources have to function? We come up with an organizational strategy, and I help them achieve. Three-dimensional leaders keep a lot. Am I going too fast? The girls are all writing, and the boys like, what did he say? It always happens to my wife and I when we're in these kind of meetings. Three-dimensional leaders keep a long-term focus on your mission, your resources, and context. No matter what you're doing, you always keep the big picture mission in mind. Mission matters most. You always keep an understanding of how your resources function, where you get them from, how they have to be trained and deployed in order to accomplish anything. And you also understand the context, the environment, the 10,000-foot objective view of where everything is on the chessboard so that you know how to position your resources to continually fulfill your mission regardless of what's happening on that chessboard. Two-dimensional leaders only get one or two of the MRC elements in focus. One-dimensional leadership is not about the mission. It's all about me. Government's mission is to facilitate a set of circumstances that make it favorable for our nation's chief resources, we the people, to actuate our lives, to use our gifts, our talents, and our abilities to innovate goods and services that other people are willing to pay for to enjoy. The context that facilitates this process is the U.S. Constitution. One-dimensional politicians only focus on their roles in government. They don't focus on what we the people need to do to be able to actuate our lives. Too many American politicians they're only focused on, well, what can the government do? It's all about me. I'm in the government. I'm going to come and talk to your organization, and I'm going to take government resources that I don't have and taxpayers' money, and I'm going to come to your organization and suck up to you and promise you stuff that I have no business promising you because it takes me out of the big picture mission of America. But I'm good. A government egotist. It's all about me.
That's good.
And then they compartmentalize legislation. People have already talked about that. They set the black people against the white people. We have to have the victim du jour. And if you're my victim du jour, I put my arm around you and I say, I'm going to protect you from all those bad people. I lose the big context focus of what America's all about, and I start to fracture our country. So I get the rich against the poor, the black against the white, the gays against the other people, and there's no peace. Great leaders, here's one-dimensional leadership characteristics. One-dimensional leadership is all about me, not the mission. Now, how do you get to be a one-dimensional leader? Well, you probably got some great personal talents. You might be an attractive person. You probably have some pretty good work habits. You got some charisma and charm. People say, well, let's put that person in leadership. What about Samson in the Bible? He's a one-dimensional leader. The Bible says, the Holy Spirit says about Samson that he is a judge over Israel. What would you expect a judge over Israel to do?
Judge.
Be involved with the people. Be concerned about what's going on with the, within the larger context of the nation. Does Samson do any of that? Samson's only worried about the girls he can chase.
Uh-huh.
Samson's like Anthony Weiner.
Watch yourself.
Samson is a great warrior. He overcomes 1,000 competitors. Everybody says, wow, he's a mighty guy. But he cared little for God's organization and mission. You want to be a good leader, you've got to rally the resources to God's cause. What would Satan's rallying cry have been? They took my girlfriend, whom God said I'm not supposed to have in the first place. Only drunks and alcoholics, womanizers and child abusers would rally to that mission. So the normal people in Israel, Samson was useless to the organization of Israel. The organization did not grow, benefit, develop one iota under Samson's so-called leadership. The Holy Spirit calls him a judge. There's nothing in Samson's behavior in the Bible that even tells us that he had a clue about why God had given him his gifts. What about you? You got some gifts and talents. Are you going to give your body to God? Or are you going to do your thing?
That's good.
Are you going to seek the humanistic horizon of self-fulfillment with all that God has given you? Or are you going to do the right thing?
That's good.
Let's talk about two-dimensional leaders. They have good skills and abilities. Remember, two-dimensional leaders only get one or two of these three elements in right. They can focus on the mission, or they talk mission, but they're not people, or they're mean-spirited, or they're liars, or they're cheats. So they're always messing around and doing the wrong thing in relation to their people resources. If I'm a drunkard, I've experienced this. I only want other drunks in leadership around me. I had a guy once tell me, he said, Earl, you don't understand. I went to a meeting and I prepared this big presentation and we decided this organization is going to do this thing. I come back to work the next day and it's all changed. And the guy says to me, well, you don't understand, Earl. You got to go out and drink with the director if you want to make sure your plans make it to the next day. I'm like, you guys made these plans on Seagram 7? You're letting Budweiser run our organization? Two-dimensional leaders, they're nice people. They contribute as team members. They bring you cookies and cake on your birthday.
Yay! My birthday's tomorrow.
But they fail to really do all the things that one would expect from a good team member. They can't see the big picture. They don't lead it well in varying different types of circumstances. I'm not going to go into all this, but I want to tell you this. The prophet Samuel was a two-dimensional leader. He understood the mission. He understood the mission enough to anoint David. I mean, Saul as king. He understood the mission enough to anoint David as king. He makes no succession plan between the two kings. He never says to Saul, Saul, you're an egotist, and God's going to kill you. But you know God has given the kingdom to David. Now, Saul, let's think about how we can make you look kingly while we grow David into the kingship position. I'm going to come back here one day and I'm going to talk to you about David and Joseph and how God moved those two men to the highest levels of leadership in the world. The problem is they were in abusive situations. David had God throwing spears at him while he was learning how the king's court operated. Some of you are in bad home situations right now and you're learning all these things about how to run America. Don't run from home. Try to stay in the game, but don't get abused by your home if you can avoid it. We're going to talk about that in the 10 minutes. Samuel doesn't understand succession planning between David and Saul. He also blows it when it comes to his retirement. He puts his two corrupt sons in charge of the kingdom. They are the wrong resources for the priestly mission. Let's talk about Deborah's three-dimensional leadership. Deborah knew that there's more than one way to do anything. When you're a young person, I was young, and you're very driven, you think, I just gotta find the right way. And the right way becomes confining for some people. Because there's always two or three or four ways to do anything. I ran an organization of 116 people, and we would go through all these matrices, and we would analyze, and we would get down to two or three options. I would flip a coin. They said, what are you doing? I said, pick one or two. The coin's going to hit the ground. I'm going to pick for you. And they said, well, what if this and what if that? I said, look, we don't have the technology to analyze the outcomes between the one and the two best ways. Let's just pick away and start moving forward. If it changes, these two variables are not that far off. We can always stop and jump onto the other track. but let's keep moving forward. She understood God's call and mission, and she rallied the resources Israel to that mission. Her chief leader resource, Barak, says, "I'm not going to go unless you go with me." She doesn't belittle him. I've heard preachers all my life say, "That man was a chump. You should have never asked that woman." I'm like, she wasn't a woman. She was God's prophet.
Amen.
If I was a girl, we don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews, but if I was a girl, I'd live my life as if a woman wrote the book of Hebrews.
My.
Christianity's doing this because of some of these stupid doctrines we have.
Yeah.
Anyway, she empowered Barak. Now, when she gets to the battlefield, she's not a one-dimensional leader. It's not all about Deborah. She lets Barak do his job. She does her job. She lets Barak use all of his general gifts, and they win the war. Wherever you see three-dimensional leadership in the book of Judges, there's peace in the land for 40 years. Wherever you see two-dimensional leadership in the book of Judges, the nation is functioning barely, and it's being controlled by the enemy. America, right now, is in a two-dimensional leadership position. We're functioning barely. Mm. Here's how we get America out of this mess. We gotta focus on the big picture. Keep the main thing the main thing.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta know which details matter. We can't be haggling each other over silly little issues. We gotta paint with a very, very broad vest. I'm looking for politicians who are about 80% of what I want and need. I'm getting behind them, and I'm supporting them. I want to encourage everybody to use their gifts. You come up with a good idea, it's not my idea, I'm going to give you credit and use your idea. It's not about me, it's about the mission. Here's one of my favorite expressions. Three dimensions are fluid because at times flexibility is just way too rigid. I'm going to go back to the MRCs of America. What's our government's mission? It's to facilitate, it's to enable our nation's chief resources, which is we the people, to use our talents to make goods and services that other people are willing to pay for and enjoy. The context that determines how government functions, the context that governs government, is the U.S. Constitution. Now, the Founding Fathers intended that we the people would self-govern under the Ten Commandments. You've heard a lot about that this week. The Founding Fathers realized that through the Ten Commandments, God was saying, you have a right not to be murdered. Actually, if you look at Commandments 1 through 4, God is saying, you have a right to worship me the way the Bible says to worship me.
Uh-huh.
Commandment number 5, God is actually saying, honor your mother and father. God is saying, honor should be the guiding principle within the home. Commandment number 6, God is saying, you have a right not to be murdered.
Uh-huh.
Commandment number 7, God is saying, you have a right not to be stolen from or have your property improperly seized. Commandment number 9, you have a right not to be lied to in a court of law. And we're going to get a jury of your peers. I've done some wrong things in my life. But they can't find 12 black guys with master's degrees and MBAs, so I can't find 12 of my peers, so I've never been tried. Commandment number 10, you have a right not to have your belongings coveted. Now I'm going to talk to you about the divine decalogue for dynamic decency. If it's divine, where'd it come from?
God.
If it's a decalogue, how many of them are there?
Ten.
Ten. And if you live by them, you will be dynamically decent.
That's good. I like that.
The Ten Commandments are all about three relationships. Commandments number 1 through 4 guides our relationship with God. Commandment number 5 guides our relationship with our family. And commandments number 6 through 10 guide our relationship to the rest of society. It's interesting. Commandment number 5 says, honor your family. Commandment number 6 says, do not murder. Why is God linking family and murder together? Where'd the first one occur? Cain killed?
Abel.
Who was his?
Brother.
Now, I don't know from personal experience, and I'm sure none of you in this room have ever experienced this, but I've heard that family can get on your last nerve. Here's a positive paraphrases of the Ten Commandments. Commandment number 1 means that God is number 1, all people are number 2s. Some people are not 3s or 4s, so that you think that you're a 2 and you can dump on them. God is number 1, all people are number 2s. God is your primary relationship. The greatest commandment is, thou shalt love the
Lord
with all thy
heart
and love your
neighbor
as yourself.
Self.
There's commandment number 2. There's God is number 1, all people are number 2s. Commandment number 2, you know why God tells you not to worship idols? It's because you imitate your idols. Mm-hmm. You become like what you worship.
That's good.
The Bible says in Romans chapter 1 that Israel exchanged the glory of the immutable God for the thing made. every nation that worships through the Old and the New Testament, we live in orderly societies and we tend to drive around on pavement. Every nation that worships the tree god, the frog god, the snake god, the olive god, the voodoo god, the olive garden god, they all drive around, walk around on dirt, and they tend to live in societal chaos. And they abuse people, and all those societies abuse women. You know why America's a big bone when we win war? Because in America, most dads treat their moms right, most. You treat mom right, then that means a guy like me gets a lot of breast milk. I get fed well. So you mess with my mother, I'm a big dude, I'm gonna come and kick your rear end. You right. Diss my mom, she can't feed me well, I grow up weak and anemic, and I lose wars. It's self-preservation to do what the Bible says. Commandment number 3, esteem God's name. You treat God's name like a G-O-D or a D-O-G. They talk about you like you're a dog. Commandment number 4, we should be Sabbath-seeking people. You know, for true believers, every day is Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. I pray every day. I read my Bible every day. Commandment number 5, honor is the guiding principle of the home. Honor is a two-way street. Parents need to be honorable towards their children. How are we honorable towards our children? I know in a room this size, I'm probably talking to a handful of kids, 2 or 3 of you. You know, every area covered by a swimming suit, we call that good touch and bad touch. If somebody's touching you in an area covered by a swimming suit, it's bad touch. The average child who is experiencing bad touch has to tell somewhere between 11 and 14 adults before it stops happening. The rule of thumb is tell and keep on telling. If you are an adult in this room and you are touching a child in those areas, and that is not an infant or a young child, you better have a washcloth in your hand, number one. But if you are doing that and going beyond that, I hope you get caught.
Amen.
Because the Bible says, I'm going to visit this sin to the 3rd and 4th generation of people. You don't want this in your family.
Yes, yes.
You don't want people walking around with this psychological trauma and the hardships of having to go through life because you can't keep your hands to yourself. Turn your computer off, stop looking at porn, and leave the kids alone. This whole program came out of that message that I wrote to my local newspaper.
Yes, that's good, Earl.
Mercy mitigates murder, commandment number 6. It's not anger management, it's mercy management. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now, if I'm angry at her, I go to anger management class. An anger management class teaches me, boy, I'm gonna get my hands on her face. Oh my gosh, she did this to me. Oh man, she's ticking me off. Just wait till I got this class. I'm going to get faith. But if I'm focused on mercy, not that faith would ever do anything like this. If faith were to do something wrong to me, then I say, I got to manage mercy in relation to faith. I have to forgive her. Thank you, faith. The Bible, Jesus said, offenses are going to come. So people are always going to tick you off. You got to learn to forgive. Commandment number 7, if you date right, you mate right.
Amen.
You date wrong, you mate wrong. Now, what does that mean? Men fall in love with their eyes, women fall in love with their
ears.
Is that true?
Yeah.
You like to hear nice things, right? So listen, boys. Now, girls, when a guy sees you, he goes, He doesn't know you. He just likes the way you walk. He doesn't know if you like dolphins or unicorns. He doesn't know if your favorite color is blue, pink, purple, or yellow. He just likes the way you move when you walk, so he goes, oh, I'm in love. He's not in love. He's in off mode. He's not thinking right. He can't hardly control himself. So what you girls have to do when that boy starts running his mouth, and men, do not say these things to girls. When the boy starts saying, oh, you sweet thing, you gotta go, I can't hear you. Because you are vulnerable to some idiot telling you nice things.
Amen.
Because men fall in love with their
eyes.
And women fall in love with their
ears.
Boys, when you see something that your eyes really should not be looking at, because Jesus said if you look, you made the mistake. See, men think, oh, I can look. No, you can't. You cannot look. It's very dangerous for us to look. Looking leads to bad things with us guys.
Amen.
Remember how you put the blinders on horses? Maybe not this. We should have goggles that say Jesus right here, you know?
I know that's right, Earl.
So, men, control yourself. Don't say stupid things to girls. Girls, if a guy is saying that to you, turn to him and say, do you know if I like unicorns or dolphins? He can't answer that. Go, yeah, I can't hear you.
That's good.
Commandment number 8. You are not stealing something and enriching yourself, you are ripping both yourself and the other person out of God's plan for your material blessing. And that means even not taking things to lost and found. Commandment number 9, to tell the truth, has two parts to it. One is the truth is all there is to tell. I usually teach this over a 3-day period of time, but 3 seminars. But the truth is all there is to tell. And number 9A. 9B is slander sells us short. Slander means I'm going to tell the legitimate truth about your past in such a way as to hurt you. Because Satan always wants the issue to be your past, your sin. Slander says, I'm going to hold it over you. And I'm never going to let you out of that cage. Why does God tell us in commandment number 10 not to covet? It's because coveting clouds your conscience. That's like, man, you see something and coveting clouds your conscience. You don't think right. You'll actually think about hurting somebody to get what they have. Now, when the government tries to overtax us, I think the government at times is coveting too much, and it's clouded their conscience. How can you be $14 trillion in debt and still running around promising people stuff? There has to be something wrong with you. Now, in the beginning, there was God or there was slime. God is the great master scientist. He made all the laws of the physical universe so that gravity holds me to the ground. He made all the laws of physics. He also made all the moral and spiritual laws. God is the great master scientist. He made your body. He made you psychologically. The Ten Commandments he gave us as a design for you to be psychologically healthy and whole. The word blessed means to be happy, well off, and contented. In the beginning, there either was God or there was slime.
Yes.
If there was God, then we all have been made the same. We all are sort of connected to each other. You cut us open, we all bleed the same blood. But if in the beginning there was God, we all climbed out of, or slimed out of the primordial blues. And somehow, a burp happened, and now we're here. And so now life is doggy dog. You are just a cosmic blip on the radar screen of eternity. I'm going to claw to the top of the hill. I'm going to beat everybody down that tries to get my way. I'm going to kick people and keep them off the top of the hill. Because life is dog-eat-dog, because in the beginning it was slime. Why are the boys saying, well, gee, I got to figure out how I don't say things to girls. And why are the girls saying, well, I really do need to figure out how not to listen to stupid things. It's because your intellect and your spirit that God has within you is rising you above the level of your passions. Mm. It's not dog-eat-dog. You want to ruin society, you have to undermine the Ten Commandments.
Yes.
If you want to destroy the greatest Christian society on the face of the earth, let me tell you what the danger of that is. If America falls as a Christian nation and the government seizes our wealth overnight, 115 million people, or probably a lot less tithers, so let's say 10 million people quit tithing overnight, orphanages around the world will put out on the street, and Muslim radicals will hack those kids to death.
That's right.
Overnight, hospitals around the world are going to close. You break us down, we are the last bastion.
Yes.
We are the last shining hill in this planet.
Amen, Earl.
Yes, yes, sir.
You can write these down. This is how you destroy a nation. You undermine respect for the Bible, which undermines respect for the family. Mom and dad. Everybody's seeking the humanistic horizon of self-fulfillment at everybody else's expense. You finally destroy the profit motive so that people like me cannot make money to tithe to my church. The government's going to determine where my money goes, not me. You do that. Orphanages, hospitals, people around the world are in great, great jeopardy. Because it is Christianity that's holding it together. Nothing else. You don't see any Muslim hospitals. You don't see any Buddhist hospitals. You don't see any communist hospitals.
My Lord, communist hospitals.
All functional relationships are relationships in which the behaviors of the partners conform to the Ten Commandments. All dysfunctional relationships are relationships that lead within at least one of the partners is violating the Ten Commandments. Hollywood is trying to deceive us. If you're rich and famous and you break the Ten Commandments in Hollywood, you go on some TV show and they applaud you for coming on a show and being a hero and telling us why you had 6 marriages and all your children had to go to the Betty Ford Clinic. But when you're a common person and you break the Ten Commandments, you're going to go on TV. It's called Cops. And these are the real tales of the Highway Patrol. And what they're going to do when they come for you, bad girl? Hollywood is on an evangelistic mission to convince people that sinning is good.
That's right.
But you know what happens to the people in Hollywood? They have a lot of money to buy themselves out of many of the earthly consequences associated with sin.
Yeah, that would.
But they got screwed up lives. They can't get along. There's all these fractured relationships. They're very unhealthy and unhappy people.
Yes.
When you live by the Ten Commandments, you are doing everything that divine love requires for your relationship with people around you. When you live by the Ten Commandments, you are doing everything that divine justice requires for the people around you. If I love you, I'm not going to murder you. If I love you, I'm not going to steal from you. If I want to be just before God, I'm not going to murder you. If I want to be just before God, I am not going to steal from you. Now, the framers of the U.S. Constitution understood that God was providing for our inalienable rights through the Ten Commandments. And they said, we're going to create this thing called freedom. If we could just get people to behave themselves under the Ten Commandments, they could be free.
Yes, yes.
And they could behave themselves. So the first thing Congress said was that we shall make no law prohibiting religion.
That's good.
Because if you take religion away, you take everything away. I already told you this, through the Ten Commandments, God is saying you have a right to worship God as the Bible says. You have a right to have honorable parents. Parents have a right to have honorable children. You have a right not to be murdered, a right not to be stolen from, a right not to be falsely accused. You have a right not to have your belongings coveted. Near the top of the Supreme Court building is the facade carved of all the lawmakers of the world, and they're all standing looking. The ones that are on this side are looking inward. The ones on this side are looking inward. Guess who's in the middle? Holding two tablets of the Ten Commandments, facing up.
Moses.
How come they didn't teach you that in school? They say we're not a Christian country. The American Battle Monuments. America runs 24 overseas cemeteries. They say we're not a Christian nation. The only land we've ever taken from those nations.